Good morning and hello everybody to my session about making virtual machines cloud native with Kubernetes. I am Mark, also known as Lintus on Twitter and GitHub. I started my career in 2001 as a Java consultant doing many projects on back-end and front-end side, very mixed setup. Then in 2015, I was working on a project about distributed applications where we quickly decided to package our applications in Docker images and to deploy them using Kubernetes in a very early version, which was quite an interesting journey. Then based on the experiences from that project, we were building a platform for our internal developers for easier deployment of the applications based on Docker and Kubernetes. Then in 2016, we added our first component written in Go to that platform, which was about doing blue-green deployments. That was a very interesting experience for me, so that I decided to search for a job where I can work as a full-time Go developer. And that was successful, that search, in 2018 when I joined Red Hat, where I worked until recently as a Kubernetes maintainer. So what do I want to show you today? We start with a short recap about virtual machines and containers and what are the differences. Then I give a quick introduction to Kubernetes. Then I introduce Kubernetes. Then I do two demos, and we end with a Q&A. So let's start with virtual machines and containers. Why do you need them? You want to run multiple applications on the same host but isolated. The first way, the older way, is doing this with virtual machines, where you run a hypervisor on your host, and the hypervisor is spinning up complete operating systems where your application is running, which offers you isolation. And the newer way is doing this with containers. They run just a single Linux process in the container, and the isolation is implemented by using kernel features like cgroups and namespaces. So here you share the same kernel with all applications. And Docker made this way easier to use and popular than it was before. So an image is more than 1,000 words. On the left side, applications without isolation. In the middle, virtualization, where you run complete operating systems on top of a hypervisor. And with containers on the right side, you share the same operating system, but run your isolated processes. So now you have your containers, you are migrating to them, or you are packaging new applications in containers. How do we orchestrate them if you have many of them and we want to run them on many servers? This is where Kubernetes enters the game. Kubernetes orchestrates many containers on many nodes. It was initiated by Google based on their experiences in their data centers, where they were using containers for a long time already. And the project was donated to the Cloud Native Computing Foundation. It has a really huge community nowadays, both for contributors and for users. And the main thing about Kubernetes is that it uses a declarative approach. That means you declare what you want to have running in your cluster, and then Kubernetes is continuously comparing this declared state with the observed state in the cluster, and it's taking action on the cluster in order to reach this declared state. So how do you declare your expected state on the cluster? So the smallest workload you have is a pod. A pod can run one or more containers. These containers are sharing network and storage. And it's very important that these pods are ephemeral. That means they can be restarted at any time, even on another node. That might happen because of node failures or other reasons. Then typically, these pods are part of a deployment. The deployment adds horizontal scaling features to pods, so we can run multiple pods of the same kind. And it can handle updates of your pods when you want to change some properties or switch to a new version. So typically, you declare these pods and deployments using YAML files. On the left-hand side, you see the deployment YAML. The important part here is replicas 3. That means you want to run 3 replicas of the same pod. And then Kubernetes is doing some kind of load balancing between them. then you can define update strategies, and then you have a template where the pod declaration comes into. And that one you see on the right side. Here the important part is about the containers. Here we just say we want to run one Nginx container, and we are planning to open the port 80. There are many more resources. The most important ones are services. So I said pods are ephemeral, and every time they are restarted, they also get a new IP address. But services offer a persistent IP address for pods, and they implement the load balancing I already mentioned. Then you have config maps and secrets. They contain configuration data, which can be consumed by your containers in the pods. Then you have the concept of persistent volumes. They are an abstraction layer for storage, and they can be backed by just files on your host or by NFS or Ceph or Gluster. There are many more providers available now. And these persistent volumes can also then be consumed in your pod, and the data is mapped to a path in your running container, for example. And then there are several resources about role-based access control. These are service accounts, roles, and role bindings, and many more, but that would go too much into detail here. So how is Kubernetes working? There are several components running in your cluster. The first one is the Kube API server. That one provides a REST API for create, read, update, delete operations on the resources. It stores the current state of the cluster in an etcd key value database, and it's basically the entry point for all other components and for users to your Kubernetes cluster. Then the next component is the Kube Controller Manager. That one is deciding which pods need to be started or deleted based on, for example, scaling of deployments or for when a node fails. And then we have the Kube Scheduler, which decides where to run these pods. And this decision is made based on resource requests you can define on your pods and on resource availabilities on nodes. So for example, if you have a node with much memory left and you have a pod which needs much memory, then the scheduler will decide, hey, this is the best node for you. And you can also define affinity and anti-affinity rules, which you can use in order to say, I want to run these pods on the same node or on different nodes. Then you have the kubelet, that is a component which is running on every host. And that is a component which is basically talking to the container runtime, for example, Docker, for actually starting the containers. Then we have a command line tool. This is called kubectl. Others name it kubectl or whatever. There's an ongoing discussion in the community. And this makes it easier to talk to the Kube API server, so you don't have to do everything with curl or something similar. You can use it for scaling deployments, creating, and deleting deployments. So again, an image with an overview. On the left-hand side, you see the so-called master or control plane, which can be one or more nodes for high availability. It runs the Kube API server, which is talking to the etcd database. The controller manager is talking to the API server. The scheduler is talking to the API server. And the kubelet, which is running on the worker nodes, is also talking to the API server and is starting the containers. So one really cool feature about Kubernetes is that you can extend its functionality. You can do this in two ways. The first one is custom resource definitions. With this, you can declare your own Kubernetes resource types. So you don't have deployments and pods, but also your own resource type. And then you implement a controller, which is then deployed as a normal deployment. And that one is watching for instances of your custom resource definition. And when it sees one, it knows what to do by, for example, creating a deployment and a config map and a service and several things for you. The second possibility for extending Kubernetes is implementing an aggregated API server. This is more low level, gives more flexibility, but is also a bit more complicated. With that, you can add new REST endpoints to the Kubernetes API server. So now we have Kubernetes for orchestrating containers, but you might also have still VMs in your company, which are managed by another orchestrator. This is not an ideal solution. So what about getting the virtual machines into the Kubernetes cluster? So you only need one orchestrator. So going back to extending Kubernetes, the idea is to create a custom resource definition which represents a virtual machine, and then you implement your controller, which is looking for these virtual machine instances, and is then actually starting a virtual machine in the Kubernetes cluster. But is it really that easy? There are some challenges. How do you actually start the virtual machine from a container? How do you integrate it with the Kubernetes network and storage? Are there things which are working out of the box? What needs to be implemented? And where do you maybe even need workarounds? So luckily, most problems are solved already. And this is where Kubernetes enters the game. So Kubernetes is an open source project implemented in Go. It was initiated in 2016 by Red Hat, but there are also contributions by other companies in the meanwhile. For example, NVIDIA added GPU support for virtual machines just a few months ago. Last year, Kubernetes was accepted as a Cloud Native Computing Foundation sandbox project. And the goal is to provide an API for running KVM-based virtual machines in Kubernetes and just let these VMs run alongside with normal containers. They should use the same network abstraction layers which are available in Kubernetes and storage abstraction layers. So what resources does Kubernetes offer? The two most important ones are virtual machines. That one represents a virtual machine which can be started and stopped. And then you have a virtual machine instance which actually represents the running virtual machine. This is a bit like when you scale a deployment with 2, 0, or 1 replicas and the pod is started or stopped. So how does it look like? On the left-hand side, you see the virtual machine. It has not that much properties. The most important one is here, should the VM run or not? And on the right-hand side, you see the virtual machine instance. If you are familiar with libvirt-d, which is used for running KVM-based virtual machines, you will see the domain over here in the spec part, where you declare which devices you want to have in your virtual machine and what resources and much more. And these are later mapped into the domain spec for libvirt-d. In this example, you see we have a container disk in the devices section, and that is mapped to the container disk volume at the bottom. And this is of type is again of type container disk. And this one is a little workaround for getting the virtual machine images into the cluster. We misuse Docker Hub a bit here. We push our images to Docker Hub, but it's not a real container image. It just contains our virtual machine image. So we load the image from Docker Hub, extract our virtual machine image, and start it. So what components do we have in Kubernetes? You will see that it's a bit similar to the Kubernetes components. So we need to implement controllers which deal with our VM and VMI resources. The implementation is done with the Kubernetes Client Go library. There is another library available nowadays which makes this even easier. It's a controller runtime library, but that was not didn't exist yet when we started with it. And every controller basically uses the reconcile loop pattern. That means that it watches for creation or updates or deletions of these VM and VMI resources. Then it declares, it compares the declared state in these resources with the actual state of the running cluster. It modifies the cluster in order to reach this declared state. And this is going on in a loop until the cluster exactly represents the your declared state. So the first controller which we implemented is the virt controller. That one is watching for the VM resources on the cluster. And when it detects that the VM should be running, it creates a VMI resource for you. And then it's also watching for these VMI resources. So remember virtual machine and virtual machine instance. Then it creates the so-called virt launcher pod. That one is scheduled by Kubernetes on a node. And when this scheduling is done, the kube controller passes the ownership of this VMI resource, so let's say the responsibility for dealing with it, to the virt handler, which is running on the assigned node. This virt handler is the next component which is running on every node. This can be done with a so-called daemon set, which is a Kubernetes resource. When it starts, it checks if KVM is available on that node and marks the node accordingly, which can be used for scheduling VMs later on. And when it needs to handle an actual VMI, it communicates with the libvirt daemon running in the virt launcher pod and tries to synchronize the declared state with the given state of the virtual machine. So now we already heard virt launcher twice. What is that thing doing? That is the component which is actually really starting the virtual machine by using a libvirt daemon. That one is talking to QEMU, which is a hypervisor, which ideally uses the KVM kernel feature for starting the VMs. But you can also enable software emulation, so you don't need KVM, but that is not recommended because it has really bad performance. Then we have a virt API server. This is implementing two things. The first one is an aggregated API server providing more REST endpoints for the running virtual machines, like starting, stopping, pausing, unpausing, connecting to the console. And it also provides some webhooks, which are used for validating virtual machines and virtual machine instances and setting some default values if they are not set by you. And last but not least, we have the virt operator. That one is a special kind of controller because that one is installing, updating, or uninstalling all the other components for you. That is doing by creating another custom resource definition, which is just called kubevirt. And when it finds such an instance of that CRD, it creates all the other components or updates it. And such controllers which handle the lifecycle of a complete application are called operators. And then, just like kubectl, we have virtcl, which you can use for talking to our new REST endpoints, like starting a VM or connecting to the console or stopping the VM. This is a very simplified overview. So we have the virt controller and virt API, which are running once or twice in a HA setup. Then we have the agent, which is the virt handler, which is running on each worker node. And that one is finally together with the virt launcher, launching the VMs. And the VMs are just running together with other containers in the same cluster in the end. So, match theory, let's do a demo. Since I'm not brave enough for doing live coding, I recorded something. So we have a Minikube cluster over here with one node. Nothing is installed yet, just the usual Kubernetes pods are running. And I already downloaded the installation manifest for kubevirt, which I'm applying now. So this is installing basically the operator. We switch to the kubevirt namespace, where everything else is going to happen now. And we see that the virt operator is starting up. So we need to wait until this is ready. So it's ready now. That means we can now install one instance of the kubevirt CRD. I already downloaded it, and that will trigger the installation of all the other kubevirt components. So let's watch for all pods. We see the virt API pods are already starting up. The order is important here, especially for updates, so that you have zero downtime upgrades for your running virtual machines. This is why the operator is so useful for us. in theory, you could just deploy everything by a manifest. The operator has some more logic for doing updates. Then when API server is ready, the word controller is also started, and the word handler. So you see here, API and controller are running in an HA setup with leader election. The handler is only running with one instance per node. And since we have one node here only, we have one word handler. We wait until everything is ready. So everything is ready. That means we can deploy our first virtual machine. So we see our CRDs are also available. And let's have a look at the YAML file of our virtual machine. So you see we are using two disks here, the container disk and a cloud init disk, which are mapped at the bottom to volumes. Again, container disk is just pulling the VM image from Docker Hub. And here we have a national disk for cloud init, which we use for setting the password in the VM. So then we can just apply this manifest. We can apply this manifest. So when we check now for the VMs, we see the Fedora VM is created, but it's not running yet. And now we use the vertcaddle tool, which I also already downloaded. By the way, you can download everything from our GitHub repository and from the release page. And we used it for starting the VM. When we look now at VM and VMI, we see running true on the VM, and the VMI is scheduling now. Scheduling means that we wait until Kubernetes decided where to run our vert launcher pod. So we already know the IP address. By the way, if you don't configure anything, the VM will get the IP address of the pod, of the vert launcher pod. We just steal it. But you can configure more complicated network setups. So we see the vert launcher pod is also running now. Now we can use the vertctl tool for connecting to the console of the running virtual machine. We can log in with the password we were setting using the cloud init. And we are inside our VM. So just be sure that this is not my local Fedora. We can show the uptime. So 0 minutes, this is really the just started VM. So this is what you can do on the command line. But maybe you like fancy UIs more. So I have another demo using the OpenShift container platform. This UI is also open source, and you can even install it on plain Kubernetes. So there is a blog post scheduled on kubeflitter.io, I think for the end of this week, which explains how to do this. What we do here, we install the kubeflit hyperconverged cluster operator. This is doing a bit more than just the vert operator. It can also install some side projects. But we use it here only for installing kubeflit. So the cluster operator is running. Let's check the running pods. And at the bottom, we see the vert operator is running now. That means we can now deploy our kubeflit custom resource for triggering the installation of the other components. In an upcoming newer version, you don't need to do this manually anymore. This will be done automatically as soon as you subscribe to this operator in this UI. But for now, we need to create this kubeflit custom resource. So, status is deploying. Let's check the actual deployments and filter it by word. So we see the word API deployment was already created. And again, this is the first component installed by the operator. The next will be the word controller. Here it is. And then, as I mentioned, that's a word handler, which is running on every node. It's not a deployment, but a daemon set. We need to switch to the daemon sets on the left menu for seeing the word handler. Here it is. So we can check the word handler's pods. Container creating is a status, so we need to wait a bit. So it's running now. That means we can create our virtual machine. Maybe you noticed it in the left-hand menu. At some point, virtual machines and virtual machine templates was added automatically. That happens when the UI detects that the virtual machine CRDs are available. And then it sees, hey, now we can deal with also with virtual machines. So we create one here. There's also a wizard, but this was not working on my setup because it is a bit limited in order to be able to run it on my laptop. So here we use a Fedora, don't use a Fedora image, but a Cirrus image, which is a very small Linux distribution. So we see the VM is status off, so let's start it. This will create the VMI. This is a bit hidden in this UI, but you see that the word launcher pod is assigned to this VM now. We can check at the events what's happening now. There we see that word launcher pod was created and it's pulling images. And then we can switch to the console, which is also integrated in this UI. And here we go. So these are all the boot messages. And then after a while, you can log in. So let's skip this because we are running out of time. So some more kubewirt features I'd like to mention here is that you also can use persistent volumes, file or block-based for writable VM images because these images which are fetched from Docker Hub are not writable, they are stateless. You can, using the CDI project, the containerized data importer, for uploading VM images into your persistent volumes. And I already mentioned that you can define a more complicated network setup with multiples. You can even define multiple network interfaces. Then we support live migration in the meanwhile, which is useful when you need to drain a node. And you can pause a VM. And in future, you can also create snapshots. But we try to implement not everything on our own, but use as much Kubernetes features as we can. So we need, for example, the snapshot feature available from the storage provider running in Kubernetes. So that's basically it. Do you have any questions? Yes.
So thank you for your talk. Well, I like the idea about kubewirt. So if you live in a Docker native environment, you don't need it, but probably you have lots of legacy infrastructure that needs this kind of implementation or could make use of it. So precondition is having Kubernetes run, have a node, at least one node that has KVM support.
Yes.
And then installing the controller.
That is all done by the word operator. Yeah, you only need to install the operator, then you create one instance of these kubelet CRD, and the rest is handled by the operator. Yeah, the details depend a bit on your network setup in your virtual machines, but basically, yes, you can create also playing Kubernetes services, which then point to your VM, yes. Do you want a t-shirt? I have some t-shirts with me.
Yes.
So, what size do you need? I have...
XL or
I think I have one or two XL. Oh, this is taking too long now. Come to me after the session. Next question. Oops. More questions? Yes.
Is it possible to use like something like auto-scaling groups on top of kubelet? Like in AWS, for example, you can create an auto-scaling group that will dynamically create new virtual machines in this group from some kind of team play. And as far as I understand that to create virtual machines dynamically is kubelet.
We also have, so the question was, sorry, I forgot to repeat the first question, if you can dynamically create VMs on the fly. So we have a virtual machine replica set, which will exactly do this for you, but we don't have autoscaling yet. But maybe you can combine it with some available Kubernetes features. I did not try that yet. Yeah. Yeah. More questions?
So I'm not a KVM specialist.
Me neither.
when I deploy containers on Kubernetes, I can handle secret injection using something like external secrets manager or something like that, injecting it as an environment variable or as a file during the deployment into my container. Can I do the similar to
Yes, you can use secrets and config maps, and they will attach as a disk to the VM. So you can read the values from a disk. Yes. Yes, but you can reuse the same tools which you use for managing your containers on Kubernetes for managing your VMs now. Because basically, you can do everything with kubectl or even with curl.
Yes,
you just have new REST endpoints for virtual machines now. Well, you always need to know in what namespace you deployed something and the name of the deployment. So for virtual machines, you have something like then API vein slash namespaces slash your namespace name slash virtual machines slash virtual machine name, and then maybe even slash start. Does that answer the question?
Yes, more or less.
Maybe we can go into more details afterwards. Yeah, but at the end, it's just calling REST endpoints of the Kube API server. So it's like kubectl. You can use it. It makes talking to the REST API easier, so you don't have to use curl on your machine. And virtctl is doing the same for the new endpoints. But at the end, it's just a REST API. More questions? Yes, please.
Do you also some experience to
I'm not sure about ARM, but we have a pull request open from a community member about adding, what was the name, PPC64 something architecture. So we are open for contributions here, but we don't provide it by ourselves. Yeah. More questions? Yes, please.
As I got your point, it's mostly to support legacy infrastructure in Kubernetes, but still, do you have any valid use cases in case if you're building something from scratch, how it can be used? Only legacy, I think it can be used even for something new, maybe when you define a development infrastructure or something like that.
Yeah, the main use case is when you want to migrate your legacy workloads to Kubernetes, but you don't have the resources to do that at one time. So, but if you want to create something new, it might be interesting to use this if your application needs some specific kernel features, because containers can't provide them, but VMs can. More questions? I don't see that, so thank you very much. And